So, really good morning to you. It's wonderful to welcome to our service this morning Cara, who we're going to give thanksgiving for the birth of Cara this morning ahead of her baptism, which will be on the 8th of October. Cara's mum is here, Samantha and Christine, Cara's grandmother. Cara's dad, unfortunately, can't make it this morning, but he will be in the subsequent things that we're doing. We've got Cara here and Joel, who's just looking around the corner there, which is lovely. So a really warm welcome to you this morning. So hopefully you should all have a blue order of service. You should have one of these lovely Thanksgiving for a child orders of service and all the other bits and bobs in your service sheet. So let's start with our first hymn, which is number 564. Let's stand and praise the Lord. So from your blue orders of service, please join in the bold type. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'd like to sit or kneel as we come to a time before the Lord, allowing him to show us the places in our lives where maybe we have fallen short. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, Forgive us all has passed, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. We are so blessed as we come before our mighty, gracious, wonderful, all-power, awesome God, that when we come to him in true repentance, he says, your sins are forgiven. It is as if they never happened. Receive that forgiveness. Stand in the grace and love of your Father, your God, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. God of glory, the end of our searching, help us to lay aside all that prevents us from seeking your kingdom and to give all that we have to gain the pearl beyond all price through our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So at this point in the service, I'm going to invite Samantha and Christine and Joel and Cara, and also Stephen and Sarah, who are our, what I like to call our church godparents, who are supporting this family through the process. So if you'd like to come out with the little sheets that you've got here so that we can give thanks for the birth of Cara. Loving God, you hold all things in life and call us into your kingdom. Help us to walk the path of your truth and fill our lives with gratitude and faith through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'm going to ask Christine to sort of stand in this morning for Christopher, if that's all right. So you're going to say these things on behalf of Christine for this morning, okay? So we're addressing here, but just importantly, grandparents as well, is just so important. So we're addressing here parents and grandparents. Do you receive Cara as a gift from God?
We do.
Do you wish to give thanks to God and seek his blessing?
We do.
I address all of you as our wonderful church family who are supporting this family as they become more and more part of our family. Will you do all that you can to help and support Cara and Christopher and Christine and the wider family as they bring up as they bring up Cara and Joel?
We will.
Thank you very much. Right, Stephen or Sarah, just going to take a bit.
God, our Creator, we thank you for the wonder of new life and for the mystery of human love. We thank you for all those who support and skill, surround and sustain the beginning of life. We thank you that we are known to you by name and loved by you from all eternity. Thank you for Jesus Christ, who has opened to us the way of love. We praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God forever. So, Cara, this is your big moment. Who's this? Who have you brought here today?
Dada.
That's Dada, is it? Can I help you, Dada? This is the thing about you which is really special. As Jesus took children in his arms and blessed them, so now we ask God's blessing on Cara. Heavenly Father, we praise you for Cara's birth. Surround her with your blessing that she may know your love, be protected from evil and know your goodness all her days. Amen. Amen. Shall we just pray this prayer together? May Cara learn to love all that is true, grow in wisdom and strength, and in due time come through faith and baptism to the fullness of your grace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So Lord God, Father of all, bless Samantha, Christopher, Christine, and the wider family. Give them grace to love and care for Cara and for Joel. Grant them wisdom and patience to provide for Cara and Joel's needs. And by their faith and example, reveal the love and truth that are in Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
So we give you a copy of Mark's Gospel. And at the end of this month, I will be coming with Stephen and Sarah, and we're going to have a meeting and talk about the baptism and all about what's going to go on in that, isn't it? So we just say, receive this book. It is the good news of God's love. Take it as your guide.
Thank you.
So together, pray, God,
our Creator, we thank you for the gift of Cara, entrusted to our care. May we be patient and understanding, ready to guide and to forgive, so that through our love, she may come to know your love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Bless you and welcome. It's lovely to have you here. Lovely.
Thank you.
So we're going to have our first Bible reading, which is me this morning. Well, I'm not the reading, but I'm giving the reading this morning. It's Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 to 13, and you will find it on page 50 of these blue pew Bibles if you want to follow it in the as I read it. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, "Make everyone leave my presence." So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard about it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." When they'd done so, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now, do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now there has been famine in the land, and for the next 5 years there will not be ploughing or reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So then it was not you who sent me here, but God. He made me father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household and ruler of all Egypt. Now hurry back to my father and say to him, 'This is what your son Joseph says. God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, don't delay. You shall live in the region of Goshen and be near me, you, your children and grandchildren, your flocks and herds, and all you have. I will provide for you there, because 5 years of famine are still to come. Otherwise, you and your household and all who belong to it will become destitute. You can see for yourselves, and so can my brother Benjamin, it is really I who is speaking to you. Tell my father about all the honor accorded me in Egypt and about everything you have seen, and bring my father down here quickly." For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Your
The reading today is from Matthew chapter 15, verses 10, I think, to 28. When he had called the multitude to himself, he said to them, "Hear and understand. Not what goes into the mouth defiles a man, but what comes out of the mouth, this defiles a man." Then his disciples came and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this saying?" But he answered and said, "Every plant which my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind, leaders of the blind. And if the blind leads the blind, both will fall into the ditch." Then Peter answered and said to him, "Explain this parable to us." So Jesus said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not yet understand that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and is eliminated? But those things which proceed out of the mouth come from the heart, and they defile a man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. But these are things which defile a man, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile a man." Then Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region and cried out to him, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David, my daughter is severely demon-possessed." But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she cries after us." But he answered and said, "I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Then she came and worshipped him, saying, "Lord, help me." But he answered and said, "It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs." And she said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table." Then Jesus answered and said to her, "O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, everybody. I was going to look at the passage in Genesis, funnily enough, in Genesis chapter 45, which is the story of Joseph revealing his identity to his brothers. And whenever I read the story of Joseph, I cannot help but start singing. Sorry, if you know Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat, is it just me? All the songs in there. I was saying to Steve this morning, I can't read Potiphar without that song coming into my mind. But I do really like that musical, actually, because it sort of brings to life the humanity, if you like, I suppose, of what was going on among all the family members. But there is one thing that's different in that passage, in that thing, which is when they come to the end of it, it's all basically Joseph was ahead of his time. It was fate, really, and he was ahead of his time. But when the situation came round, it turned out all okay. And that's not actually what Joseph says. Joseph himself, we hear in this passage, gives his understanding of what all his journey up to that stage had been about. And he says it to his brothers. And before I read it, it's a really moving scene, this scene, where it says at the beginning, because he's been talking to his brothers a couple of times, but not told them who he was. And then this scene begins. It says he can't control himself anymore, and he asks everyone to leave. And I suppose if you didn't know what happened and you read he couldn't control himself, you might think he was going to throw things at them. Or he had great authority. He had actually power over their lives in the position that he was now in. But it's not anger that he's trying to control. It's just the emotional... there's just such a tremendous emotion at seeing his brothers again and hearing that his father is still alive and being able to say, "Don't you recognize me? It's me, your brother Joseph." And there's much weeping and falling on the neck of his brother Benjamin, who had the same mother. And he brings his brothers close to him, and he kisses them all at the end there, and he weeps on Benjamin. It's like he's been holding this in for such a long time, and now all the fullness of his emotion at being reunited with his family and being able to say who he is all coming out. But when he speaks to them, he says this in chapter 45, verse 5. Well, let's go back a bit. He says, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and yet there are 5 years in which there will be neither ploughing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God." And then he speaks of the authority position that God has placed him in, and that he's now able to, if you don't know the story, it was because he understood a dream of Pharaoh's that he's able to, which a gift that God gave him, that he's able to tell the Pharaoh that there's going to be 7 years of plenty and then 7 years of famine, so they need to store up everything in the years of plenty to prepare for the years of famine. And he says, at this time, 2 years of famine have already been. So, by my calculation, and according to what it says in the Bible, that would make Joseph 39. Because he was 30 when he told Pharaoh the dream. They've had 7 years of plenty and 2 years of famine, so that makes him 39. So he hasn't seen his brothers for 22 years. Yeah, 22 years. A long time. And they, in their turn, have thought he was dead. And when you start looking at this and start paralleling it with Jesus, there are so many parallels. It's amazing that Joseph is like an Old Testament foretelling of Jesus' resurrection, and because, if you like, he figuratively died and resurrected, and he went ahead for his brothers, and he was reconciled to those outside his family before he came and was reconciled to within his family. But I'm not going to preach on that today. I want to preach on this understanding that Joseph has, because Joseph does not say it was fate or, "Oh, hey ho, I was ahead of my time." It's not what he says. This is his testimony. He says, "No, God did this. God has sent me ahead of you." And he says, "And it was to save lives." And Joseph saved many, many lives. His understanding meant that Egypt became a place where the whole known world at the time went to get supplies, because the famine hit that area so severely. So he didn't just save the lives of his family, but he saved the lives of many, many people in Egypt and beyond. So, as I say, he preserved many lives. And he has reconciled himself to the understanding that actually he doesn't pretend that they didn't do wrong to him. He says it quite clearly to them. You sold me into slavery, but you don't need to feel bad about it. I'm not angry with you anymore. Because God was doing something within that, and I've seen that. And once Joseph had seen that, it changed his whole view of what had taken place. And I just want to have a little recap of Joseph's life. Again, it's a story, there's another bit from the, not that I'm preaching from the musical, but there's another bit in the musical that always strikes me, because there's a bit in the, well, just before they have the interim, what do they call it?
Interval.
Interval, yeah, the ice cream. there's a bit where they say, we've read the book and you come out on top, you know. And it struck me because I think very much when we read the Bible or we read the stories in the Bible, especially when we're really familiar with them, we know what happens and we sort of forget that the person going through it doesn't. You know, they haven't read the book and they don't know how it ends. And Joseph's ordeal started when he was 17. At that time he had had some dreams that God had a purpose for him that meant that he was going to be in a position of high authority. Those dreams didn't go down well with his brothers. He was already spoilt, or the favorite of his father, which made them even more annoyed. And they decide to kill him. And they, instead of killing him, one of them speaks up and says, well, let's not kill him. Let's just sell him into slavery. And so that's what they do. They sell him into slavery. And then they do something so horrible, really. They take his coat and they put goat's blood on it. And they take it to Jacob and say, oh, he died. And Jacob, the father, mourns his son and truly believes that Joseph has died. And meanwhile, Joseph goes through this process. Now, I don't know if any of you have had a word from God or have an understanding that God's given you, that you're called for a particular purpose. Maybe he has said there is a purpose for your life. It doesn't necessarily mean being a vicar or ordained. It can be also, there's all sorts of purposes that God has. But sometimes when you get prayed for and somebody gives you a word or says, oh, this is what God's plan is for you, whatever, it can be wonderful. You know, you can go home thinking, oh, wow, God's got a purpose for me. How brilliant is that? And it must have been, I imagine, a bit like that for Joseph. I'm having these dreams. Gosh, I'm going to be somebody. I'm going to be a somebody. I'm going to do something great for God. And then from there, almost from the, you know, from that point, he was plunged into the most horrible experiences that went the opposite direction to what he thought. And the first thing was he was in Potiphar, I won't sing, Potiphar's household, and he sort of thought, oh, I could probably just about cope with this. You know, I'm doing quite well. You know, I'm being recognized by Potiphar. Maybe this is how I end up in a position of authority. And then, as we know, he resists the wife who wants to sleep with him, and he gets accused of rape and flung in jail. It's referred to as the pit. So I don't think it's a particularly nice kind of jail that he's in. And we don't know exactly how long he's at Potiphar's house, but we know there's a gap of 13 years between being sold into slavery and coming out of prison. And every so often you get a little glimpse of Joseph, and he says something, a little sound bite. And the last one we hear is 2 years before he comes out of prison, when he says to the people that he he interprets some dreams for. He says, I'm not supposed to be in here. This is Sarah's translation. I'm not supposed to be. I haven't done anything. Please, when you get out, speak to Pharaoh. Get me out of here. And there's this, again, really horrible line that just says, but they forgot him. And that's exactly the position that Joseph is in. He's in obscurity. He's lost his reputation. He has nothing. He's a prisoner in a foreign land. And even the people he helped have forgotten him. He's forgettable. He's forgotten. And I always wonder what that was like for Joseph. What was he doing inside his mind and his emotions with, this was not what God promised, this was not what was said, this was not how it was meant to be. And we don't hear anything more from Joseph until Pharaoh starts having his dreams. And then somebody remembers, oh, hang on a minute, there's a man who's in prison who's quite good at interpreting dreams, and out he comes before Pharaoh. And in pretty much one day, he goes from total obscurity, no reputation, and nothing and nobody forgotten, to second in command only to Pharaoh. And I always find that it makes me think, this story, about the process that God puts us through when he is preparing us for the things he has for us in our life. Because there tend to be stages. First of all, there will be some understanding that God set us aside for something, or that God has a purpose for us. And the Bible is clear that every single one of us has a particular purpose that God has for us. That might be a one-off moment at a particular time, a bit like Joseph, or it might be an ongoing purpose in our lives. But it's very clear in the Bible that God wants us to know what it is and to walk in it, because it will bring us fulfillment. But the second thing I notice is that we might know something of what that is. But the next stage will be the preparation. One of the things I really like about the Old Testament, but it's similar in the New Testament. You just don't get so many stories in the New Testament. You get more letters. But in the Old Testament, there's lots and lots of stories about men and women who realized, or God showed them, that he had a purpose for them. And then they went through ordeals for years. Sorry about that. They went through years of not knowing what happens next, of not knowing how this is going to work out, because it's the opposite. You see, if I was training Joseph, because I'm a bit boring, I'm not nearly as interesting as God, if I was training Joseph to be second in command to Pharaoh, I would have probably sent him to, I don't know, Egyptian training school for helping pharaohs. I might have given him a placement. We might have got him connected to the right kind of people so that he would get in the right kind of and get noticed by Pharaoh. We might have given him, this is how the world would approach it, give him some lessons in how to be connected and networking and all of these things, and how to present yourself in court and do all the right things. God gave him none of that at all. When he appeared before Pharaoh, he was a prisoner. He's probably quite smelly. He was nothing and nobody, because God was going to make it absolutely clear that Joseph was going to be put in that position because God was going to put him in that position. And God's preparation was much more about the heart and the character of Joseph than it was about, I don't know, having the right appearance. And this is the same process that he puts us through. The process he puts us through is to prepare our character, if you like, prepare who we are. Joseph was going to carry tremendous power and authority, and God knew how to prepare the man to walk in that authority so that he could walk in it justly and well. And that's what God was doing in Joseph. Now, I just want to make one thing clear. I do not believe for a moment that God does horrible things to us in order to prepare our character. I don't think that. We live in a world that is fallen, and horrible things are happening all the time because we are in a fallen world. That is not how God intended the world to be. Sadly, it was what we chose when we turned away from God. And now we live in this. Now God has a plan to restore it. He sent Jesus ahead, like he sent Joseph ahead, to save lives and to restore. In the meantime, we live in a world where the enemy attacks us, basically, because that's his way of attacking God. And he attacks the creation. I remember somebody describing, I think it was Bill Hybels, describing sin like a bullet ricocheting around a small enclosed space, and it will just hit anyone and everywhere where it might land. Actually, until somebody will take it. That's part of forgiveness, but that's another story. What God is brilliant at doing, though, is where we are in a fallen world, he can take the horrible things that happen to us and he can use them to produce life. That's one of his expertise. It's not that he says those things don't happen, and it's not a sort of shrugging, oh, everything's God's will. It's not a distance thing. It's actually allowing us to see that when we offer these situations and the horrible things that happen to God, allowing him to take that and make it work for good, not just for us, but beyond. And one thing with God is that anything we offer him, he will use it to the max. If something like sin or the enemy has caused pain, when God takes it, he will use it in such a way that it produces the maximum life. He just takes, if you like, what the enemy throws at us, and God molds it and throws it back. And what gets thrown back is something far more beautiful, far more powerful for God's purposes. Now, please don't misunderstand me. That doesn't discount the pain. Because the God I know feels our suffering. And he doesn't take it lightly. And please don't take my message to mean that those things are light. But I also know a God who is able to take that pain and transform our lives and the lives of those around us, if you see what I mean. And work something in our lives to such a degree that we can be free and at peace. Which, if you like, is what we hear from Joseph. This little bit of Joseph, it's like having him front for testimony time. These are these horrible things that happened to me. But now I realize that God was doing several things in Joseph's life through the horrible intentions that his brothers had. God took that and worked it for good in Joseph's life. So God was doing several things. One thing, the first thing he was doing was he was positioning Joseph. God was positioning Joseph where he needed to be. Joseph says, God sent me ahead to preserve life. He wasn't the victim of his brother's vendetta. He was a person sent by God. And God positioned him perfectly. If he had managed to persuade somebody to get him out of prison 2 years early, I don't know if Pharaoh would know where to find him. Do you know what I mean? God was keeping him in place where he would be found when he was needed. And the second thing that God was doing was, in those years, God was working deeply in Joseph's heart. In a sense, Joseph was being separated from any way that he could somehow make what he thought God wanted to do in his life happen. He was actually left in a position where he was dependent entirely on God. And when he is brought before Pharaoh, he says very little. He says, only God can interpret dreams. Tell me what you've seen. It's a very different speech from the things you've heard Joseph say before, which are a lot longer, a bit like my sermon. And I suppose I just wanted to encourage you on several levels, depending on where we are. First of all, God has a purpose for each and every one of us. It's not always what we think it is. And even when we know he has a purpose for us, we don't always know exactly what it's going to look like. It's just one of those things. But he does want us to know. And it doesn't matter if we've been a Christian for 5 minutes, or I was going to say, or 100 years, but I don't think there's anybody here who's been a Christian for 100 years. There is a purpose, and God wants us to know what it is, and we can ask him. And what happens is, you don't necessarily get the whole picture, but you start to realize that he is starting to position you. The second thing is, you might know what God's call on your life is, and your life doesn't look anything like you thought it would. And it just feels hopeless. So you're in that place a bit like, you know, like Joseph, when you don't know the end yet, and you're not understanding what's going on. And in that situation, I really believe that God wants us to understand the work he's doing in our lives. And we can ask him, and he can reveal that to us. And finally, we might be on the other end, where we're looking back and beginning to realize, oh, that's what God was doing. And that is a place of peace, because we begin to recognize that what we thought were things being done to us, there was actually the hand of God at work in our lives, producing something beautiful. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for each and every person here and anyone listening. We're not recording. We are recording. Can't remember. Anyway. But Lord, I thank you for each and every person here. And I ask that you'd reveal to us your purposes, the things that you are at work at in our lives. I ask, Father, you'd open our eyes, like Joseph's, to see the hand of God, to see what you are doing, so that we can walk with you and rejoice with you in all that you are doing in our lives and far beyond. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Be really blessed. Thank you.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. If you'd like to now sit or kneel, Julian will lead us in our intercessions.
Just before we start, I'd like to just share a little bit of news. We have prayed quite a lot for a lady called Irene Howard, who was part of this church for over 20 years until a very short time ago. And Irene has gone through a pretty awful time over the last couple of years in particular in her own family. She's lost her husband, and this year she lost her son as well. I was able to go over to Ireland and see her for a couple of days and spend some time with her daughter, Ali, who runs a Christian bookshop over there. And Irene is now very much more settled in Ireland. That's difficult to say, isn't it? And has her own little dog called Rona, and her own little ground floor flat, which overlooks a very nice park in Ballyclare, which is a satellite town of Belfast. And so an answer to all our prayers for her going through a very, very rough time and difficult time, and a time when she was really very badly, in a very bad place indeed. So I thought you might like to know that. While I was over there in Northern Ireland is part of the UK, but it's a very different part of the UK to here in lots of ways. There's a much stronger sense of religion being a strong part of what glues their community together, but also a lot of division as well. Ali actually took me down the Falls Road in Belfast, and we drove down there. It's perfectly safe to do that nowadays, but the murals from the horrible protests that took place there, and the wall which divides the Catholic and Protestant communities, is still there. And you have these amazing drawings on the walls of the wall down the Falls Road, which includes quite a lot of Christian Bible verses on the walls as well. So it's interesting. We'll pray this morning also for Ireland. So let's pray. Jesus said, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." Lord God, as we come to you this morning and we pray for our world, we pray for the nations of Ireland, both north and south, and the times they are going through there. We pray for peace to come to that land in a bigger way than is the case now. We pray for government to be restored. And we pray for you to be honoured in those countries. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for our community here in Poringland, and as people await the results of exams, we pray for our young people, especially those known to us, and we pray for them as they seek to make decisions about further education and life beyond school. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, this morning we want to give thanks to you for Irene and the way she has pulled through such difficult circumstances in her life and come to a better place. We pray for her and her family in Northern Ireland. And as we give thanks for her, I want to ask each one of you to pray for somebody who is going through a tough time at this moment. To pray that God would be close to them. To pray that their needs will be supplied. To pray for good relations in their families. And to pray that above all, they will know your presence with them, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray this week for ourselves, that we may be a witness to you, that as we have prayed about your purpose for our lives, we pray we may be open to your voice calling us, and that we may be open to which things and people we should be supporting. We pray above all that we may witness to your love and grace, and that others may come to know you through our witness. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. The peace of the Lord be always with you." Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace.
Thank you.
Lord of all mercy, we, your faithful people, have celebrated that one true sacrifice which takes away our sins and brings pardon and peace. By our communion, keep us firm on the foundation of the gospel and preserve us from all sin through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. So, words of blessing. Whatever you have received from the Lord today, be it challenge, be it comforts, be it healing, take it with you, enjoy it, grow through it, and share it with others. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you all now, with your families, and all those who you come into contact with this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our final hymn is number 481.